Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So let's get started. Yesterday we were looking at synchronous round-based systems and we considered the case of crash failures, and we've shown how to solve consensus in T plus one rounds. We also gave algorithms for early design consensus, where the number of rounds required for decision depends on the actual number of failures as opposed to the maximum number of failures, which is the parameter T. We, at the very end, we also looked at the power problem of terminating reliable broadcast, which turns out to be equivalent to consensus in such systems. Today we're going to continue and talk about Byzantine failures, so algorithms for round-based systems that can tolerate Byzantine failures. And after that, we're going to move to asynchronous systems. And I should point out that many of these results that hold for one type of system, for synchronous systems, may not hold for asynchronous systems. For example, in asynchronous systems, as we shall see, it's impossible to solve consensus. And some of the equivalences that hold for synchronous systems do not hold for asynchronous systems. So let's move on then to handling Byzantine failures in synchronous systems. Now it turns out that the consensus problem as it is stated for crash failures cannot be solved if you have Byzantine failures. So what I've shown here is the three properties for the consensus problem in for crash failures, and what you can see with the red line crossed out was the definition that we had for crash for systems with crash failures. And if you wanted to ensure the property, the validity property, which is crossed out by red, it turns out that it is impossible to ensure that if some correct process decides V, then V is the initial value of a process. And the intuition for this is because when you have Byzantine failures, essentially processes can be lying about what they have. And if you think of a situation where each process has a different value, and they run consensus and end up deciding a value, let's say value V0, let's say that value V0 belongs to some process P0. Well, that process could have just lied about what its initial value really was, but executed the algorithm exactly as if its initial value was V0, ended up deciding on V0, but actually its initial value could have been something completely different, and in the end, you decide on something which has nothing to do with the initial value of the process. So we have to weaken this property and have this property which is shown here without the red lines that says that if some correct process decides V, and all correct processes start with the same initial value, then V is going to be that decision value. And the other properties of consensus remain the same. The agreement property says that no two correct processes decide different, and the termination property, as you would expect, just says that correct processes eventually terminate their execution. The terminating reliable broadcast problem can also be defined for Byzantine failures. And this problem is also known as the Byzantine generals problem, which you may have heard of, or the interactive consistency problem. And I'm not going to go through the definition in details, but similarly to consensus, you have to change slightly some of the definitions so that they can be implemented with Byzantine failures. I'm now going to give you an algorithm for consensus that can handle Byzantine failures. And the hard thing about Byzantine failures, as I suggested before, is that with Byzantine failures, you can have processes, not defaulted processes, are not executing the protocol that they are supposed to execute. And so, for example, if the protocol says that the process should send a value to everybody else, the Byzantine process, the process that suffers a Byzantine failure, can send different values to different processes, or it may not send a value to some process and send a value to other processes. And in fact, we can think of a Byzantine process as trying to maximize the damage that it's trying to inflict on the system, whereas the correct processes are trying to achieve the properties of consensus. Now, the algorithm that I'm going to give you to solve consensus with Byzantine failures assumes that n is greater than or equal to 3t plus 1. Now, if you recall, n is the number of processes in the system, and t is an upper bound on the number of failures that can occur. And so what this inequality is saying is that the upper bound in the number of processes has to be less than one-third of the number of processes in the system. Right? You just change the equation, you get to has to be less or equal to n minus 1 divided by 3, which essentially means that t has to be less than n divided by 3. And so here's the algorithm. In the first round, the basic idea is that, well, initially what each process has is its own initial value. So the process, each process will send that initial value to all the other processes. Well, the correct processes, that is, will send their initial value to the other processes. The Byzantine processes may be sending different values. Now, each process is going to receive that value from each one of the other processes, and it's going to create a tree, which is shown on the right here. And the intuition of this tree is that in the roots of the tree, we have the process own initial value, and we're going to construct a tree that has information about what the other process's initial value and what you think are the other process initial value as the protocol executes. And so in the first level of the tree, below the root level, the process is just going to record the initial values that it has received from each other process. If I get my pointer here, and so if this is the tree for process one, the root has a label that says this is the empty string and says this is my initial value. At the first level of the tree, the process will record the value that it received in the first round for each one of the processes. And so this is the value that process one received from process two in the first round. And you notice that process two started with an initial value of y. And if that process was correct, it sent that value to everybody. And process one received that value and recorded the fact that process two has initial value y. And similarly, process three reported to process one that it has initial value x. And process four reported to process one that has initial value z. Now, you notice that if a process is correct, it will send exactly the same initial value to all the other processes. And so if you look at the tree of correct processes, and you look at the specific node here, and the specific corresponding node here, you'd expect the value here to be the same if the process was correct, the process sending that value. And the fact that 3 has a different value in this tree than it has in the other tree means, assuming that processes 1 and 2 are correct, means that 3 has sent different values to processes 1 and processes 2. Of course, it could also be the case that it's not 3 the process which is Byzantine, but it's actually 2 the process which is Byzantine. It has actually received the correct value from process 3, which is sent to everybody, but then 2 decided not to follow the algorithm and record a different value in its own tree. So that's also a possibility. So that was the first round of the protocol. And what's going to happen in the second round of the protocol is that all the processes are going to send the first level of the tree that they have to all the other processes. And if it's a correct process, it's supposed to send exactly the same message to all the other processes. And when a process receives that message, it's going to receive a message from all the other processes. It's going to extend its tree by one more level. And in the second level, it's going to record the value that it has received from the other processes in the following way. So in this node, the process 1 records what is the value that it has received from process 1 itself. So this is not very interesting, but no, the process is sending to itself at this level. So over here, process 1 is recording what it has received from process 2 at that position. In other words, each process has a certain value for this position of the tree. In the case of process 1, the value is x. In the case of process 2, well, I'm not showing the tree here anymore, but it was a different value, it was the value y. And over here, process 1 is recording what is the value that it has received from process 2 for that position in the tree. What is the value that process 1 received from process 4 for that position in the tree, and so forth. And you do this for all the nodes that you have here, so you can create children for those nodes. I should make an observation that I'm not showing, first of all, the entire tree here, because this tree is actually going to get quite big. But also, we're going to skip the messages that a process has received from processes that are already shown as ancestors. So because process 3 already appears an ancestor here, we don't have the label 3-3 there. So we're just not going to record that value in the tree, even though the value may have been received. And this continues. So in round 3, what's going to happen is that all the correct processes will send what they had in level 2 to everybody else, and it's going to record the values that it receives in the next level of the tree. And so you can see here that in round three, this value here, or this value is probably more interesting. So this value here is what process one received for process four, from process four, regarding this position of the tree that process four is currently storing, assuming that process four was a correct one. So z means that process four had at this position value z. The z here means that process five had a z at this position, and so forth. And what we do is we execute this algorithm for t plus one rounds. And at the end of t plus one rounds, what you have to do is execute another phase of the protocol that I'm going to describe shortly that will basically clean up the tree. And once you clean up the tree, you can go ahead and decide. But let me point out first, before I talk about the next phase, that this phase of the protocol involves a huge amount of information being sent, exponentially large amount of bits in the round that you are executing, or the number of rounds that you have to execute. And the reason for this is that for each new round, you have to send all the information that you had in the previous round for all the other processes. And so this information can grow quite quickly. At the end of t plus one rounds, the message will end up being quite large. This protocol is also known as the exponential information tree protocol because the tree is growing exponentially, or also the full information protocol, where in each round, essentially, the process is sending all the information that it has to all the other processes, and you iterate that, for each one of the rounds. OK, so once you have executed t plus one rounds, and now you have this huge tree, what you have to do is to execute a phase, which is just a local phase, doesn't involve any communication, that will clean up the values in the tree. You notice that if processes lie about what their value is, they may send different values to other processes. But once they send different value to other processes, in the next phase, the other processes will report back to all the other processes the values that they received. And so you're able to look at the tree and see that there were some inconsistencies in the information that was broadcast by each process in each round. But in the end, you don't really know if the inconsistency really comes because the initial process sent an incorrect value, or the process that was reporting the value of the initial process is reporting an incorrect value for that process. And so the cleaning procedure is intended to try to extract as much truthful information as possible from this huge tree based on looking at what a majority of the processes think is the correct value for each one of the nodes in the tree. Because you notice that there's a much larger proportion of correct processes than there is of Byzantine processes in this algorithm. We're assuming that t is less than n over 3. And so if there are liars in the system, they're going to be less than one-third of the processes. And you'll be able to see that there is information that is inconsistent in the tree and try to filter out that information. Is a question? No. So what we assume here is that if you receive a message, you know where the message is coming from. Right, yeah.
So what's the setting where that assumption holds, but at the same time you worry about the
behavior of the practical viewpoint? So the assumption doesn't hold. In other words, you receive a message, but you don't know where the message came from.
No. You need to know where the message came from, right?
Yes.
So given that assumption, what's the practical setting where that assumption holds, but at the same time you have to worry about
Wait, but that's the assumption that it holds here already, right? So in the sense that you know where messages comes, then you have to worry about Byzantine behavior.
Yeah, so what he's asking you is there a practical setting in which you are worried about Byzantine behavior on the one hand, and on the other, you can assume that you can authenticate whoever is on the other side of your channel?
Yeah, it's OK. Fair enough. So this is a case where, for example, you trust the communication layer that when it gets a message to you, it's correctly reporting where the message is coming from. And what you're not trusting is the behavior of processes. So you can think that such behavior could arise, for example, in the context of having a bug in your system, right? So you have a process that is supposed to execute its code, but it deviates from the code because of the fact that it has a bug in its operating system or a bug somewhere else. So another case might be that somehow you have a black box or you have a trusted computing component in your system that guarantees that once a process puts that message inside that black box, which is trusted, the box will correctly convey the message to the other processes and will correctly indicate the source of the message. So that would be another setting where this could make sense. So this phase of the protocol after round t plus 1 is intended to clean up the bad values. And we're going to execute a recursive procedure here where we start with the leaf nodes. And we clean up the leaf nodes. And then recursively, we look at the parents of the leaf nodes. And we clean up the parents of the leaf nodes. And we do that for all the levels of the tree until we get back to the root of the tree. And so the basic idea is that each process is executing this cleaning procedure. Now, in order to clean a leaf node that process has, the process has this huge tree, there's nothing to do. In the leaf nodes, the value just remains exactly the way it is. And the reason for this is that you don't really have enough information to determine whether a leaf node is actually correct, the information that is correct or not, because you would only get that information if you were to execute another round where processes would report the value that they have for that position, and then you'd be able to say, okay, somebody has lied here. But if you're just looking at the leaf nodes that you have, you don't have that information. This is the fresh information that you got in round t plus 1. You don't know if that information is correct or not. So you just leave it the way it is. Now, what you do now, recursively, you look at the parents. In order to clean up the parent, you look at all the children, and you check to see if the children has a value v which appears a majority of times amongst all the children. And if that's the case, you change the value of the parent to be the value which appears as a majority of the children. And so I think I can depict this here. It's depicted that, let's see. So process one is cleaning up this node here. Well, the bottom nodes were cleaned up. There's nothing to do. To clean up this node, you look at the children. You realize that there's a majority of values that don't match the x. A majority of values says z. And so the cleaning procedure will change this value from x to z. And the reason we're doing this is because there's a majority of processes that is telling that the value of this position is not really x, it's z. And if there's a majority of processes telling you that, you better trust it, because at least one of these processes is going to be a correct process. And so this guy gets changed to z. We similarly apply the cleaning procedure to this node. And I didn't show what the children are, but supposing that a majority of the children had z, this gets cleaned to z, this gets cleaned to z. Now we apply the cleaning procedure to this node. The majority of children have z. Well, I haven't shown what this child has, but it may have been a different value. Even so, a majority has z, so you change this to z. And finally, you end up in the root, and you clean up the root as well. And when you get to the root, you get the cleaned value. You just decide on that value, and that's the end of the protocol. So recap of the algorithm is that you execute this algorithm for t plus 1 rounds, where in each round you're basically sending all the information that you have received so far. So while executing this algorithm, you're creating this tree, which is exponentially large and has t plus 1 levels besides the root level. You execute the cleaning procedure where you start from the leaves and you start moving up until you clean the roots. And then you decide on the value of the roots. Now we're going to show that this protocol actually solves consensus, satisfy all the properties of consensus. And I'm going to use the following terminology in the proof. So for the tree of a process, I'm going to call this quantity here the label of the specific node. And this quantity is going to be called the value associated with that label, or the value of that label. And you notice that a given label may appear and will appear in the trees of many different processes. And so the node that has a label 1, it will appear in the tree of process 1, process 2, process 3, and so forth. And so there are many nodes that have exactly the same label across different processes. But within a single process, there's a single node that has that label. There is a question there? Well, so a majority means that more than half of the values have to be exactly the same for you to clean. And so what you're picking is essentially the value that appears the most among the children. And then you set the value of the parent as being the clean value.
But the majority,
so you have 3f plus 1 nodes. Well, you don't get exactly 3f plus 1, because if you recall that when you're constructing the tree, you have to omit certain nodes in the tree here. And I don't think I emphasize this very strongly, but you're not putting nodes here that appear already if you look at the path from the node back to the root. And so the node 3 appears here, the node 2 appears here, and so you're not going to have the node which is labeled 3, 2, 2, or 3, 2, 3, because these nodes appear previously in the path. So by the time that you get at the very bottom of the tree, you don't really have 3t plus 1 nodes there to pick from. But you're going to have that minus t, because that's exactly the number of levels that you have in the tree. OK, so in order to show that the thing works, we need to show the properties of consensus. Well, here's two critical definitions that we're going to need in the proof. Now, suppose that we look at the tree of all different processes in the system, and we look at a specific label, and recall that the specific label appears in all the trees of correct processes. So the incorrect processes may only have garbage. So we say that a given label is very nice if the value associated with that label, if you look at all the correct processes, is going to be exactly the same. In addition to that, the clean value that occurs associated with that value is going to be exactly the same as the original value that was put there. So in other words, very nice means that all the correct processes agree on what should be associated with that label. More or less, when you execute the cleaning procedure, you don't change that value. And we're going to say that a label is nice as long as the clean values is exactly the same in all correct processes. And so it's possible that the original value has diverged, but when you went ahead and cleaned the value now is the same at all the correct processes. And a simple observation here is that if a node is very nice, then it's also nice. OK, now the first property of this labels and the value of the labels is that if you take any label that ends with the correct process, then its value has to be exactly the same at all the correct processes. In other words, take a label 3 to 4 here. And let's suppose that 4 is a correct process. Now look at the tree of all the correct processes. My claim is that you're going to see exactly the same value. And I'm not talking about the clean value here. I'm talking about the original value. You're going to see exactly the same value before the cleaning procedure at all the correct processes. And the reason this lemma holds is, well, we have to think about how is this value showing up here. And what this value represents is basically what process 4 told the process about what its 3-2 label was. So the 3-2 label is sitting here, right? And process 4, when it's executing the algorithm, in this case, in the third round, will tell, what is my value of the 3-2 label? And we're assuming that process 4 is a correct process. That means that it's going to tell exactly the same thing to all the other processes. And when the processes, if a process is correct, goes and constructs a tree based on what process 4 has told them, it's going to put exactly the same value there. And so that means that the value that the correct process will put here will be exactly the same. In other words, what this is saying is that the only way that you're going to have different values here for a given label, if you look at the correct processes, is if the process which is responsible for creating that label is lying, is telling a different value to different processes. OK, now I'm going to relate this property to the notion of nice labels. In the next lemma, and this is going to be the longest lemma in the proof, I guess you can guess by the size of the font here, it's going to have a little bit of a more intricate proof. But once you're done with this lemma, the rest of the proof is going to be fairly easy. So this lemma is saying that if you look at label that ends with a correct process, just like in the previous lemma, so then this label not only is going to be the same at all the correct process, but its label is actually going to be very nice. Now, if you recall the meaning of very nice, that means not only that the label is the same at all the correct processes, but the clean value is the same at all correct processes, and the clean value is equal to the original value at all the correct processes. And so that's what the lemma is saying. And this proof is going to proceed by induction on the length of the label. We're going to start essentially an induction in the tree, starting from the leaves of the trees and then going back to the roots. And so the base case is when you look at a label that refers to one of the leaf nodes in the tree. And if you call the previous lemma that says that if a label ends with a correct process, then its value is going to be exactly the same at all the correct processes, plus the fact that when the algorithm is executing the cleaning procedure, it's not changing the leaf nodes at all. It just keeps the value that was there. It follows by this that the value that has been cleaned is equal to the original value, and the value is going to be exactly the same at all the correct processes. And so therefore, by the definition, what it means for a label to be very nice, that label is also going to be very nice. And so that's the Bayesian induction. If the label refers to a leaf node, or if the size of the label is equal to t plus 1, the lemma holds. Now, the induction hypothesis is that, now take any label that has a certain size, which is less than or equal to t. So it refers to a label which is not on the leaf node. And assume that the lemma holds for labels that are larger than x, or intuitively, the lemma holds for all the labels that are below that label in the tree. Okay, now, by the previous lemma, we're assuming that the label ends with the correct processes, and so we know that its value is exactly the same at all the correct processes. And so let's call this value, which is the same, v. What we need to show is that the cleaning procedure will not touch that value, because once it doesn't touch the value, that means that the clean value is going to be exactly equal to the value, and the clean value will be exactly the same at all the correct processes. Okay. Now, think about what happens in the round that is essentially responsible for that label. And so, let's look at the round that is actually sending this label so that you create the tree, that is, you create the level of the tree which is one after what the label is referring. In other words, let's look at what happens in the next level of the tree. So when you execute the round that is actually sending the value associated with that label, the processes will essentially create the next level in the tree. And what we're going to be doing here is to look at the children of that node in the next level of the tree. Because if you recall what the cleaning procedure does, it looks at the value of the children, and then it picks the value which appears a majority of times, and then it sets the value of the label to be that value that appears a majority of times. So we're going to be looking at that round. So in round X, all the correct processes will send V as the value of the label X, because the value of the label is exactly the same at all the correct processes. So that means that if you take any correct process, C, if you look at the value of the label that that process records there, given the fact that the value is coming from a correct process and C itself is correct, it's going to correctly record the value in its children. And so the value of the label XC on a correct process is going to be exactly V as well. Now we can use our induction hypothesis because the length of XC is 1 larger than the length of X itself. And so the clean value that appears there is also V, because that label is very nice. Now, a majority of the children of label X are actually children that come from correct processes. In other words, a majority of children of X are nodes that have label of the form XC for a correct process. And this comes from the assumption that we're assuming that t is less than n over 3, which is the same thing as saying that n is going to be greater than or equal to 3t plus 1. Now, I mentioned to you that the levels of the tree don't have 3t plus 1 children, but they're going to have, because you're going to eliminate some of the children, but they're going to have at least 2t plus 1 children. It depends exactly on the level. The levels that are higher up will have more children, but at the very bottom, you're going to have at least 2t children. At least 2t plus 1 children. And you know that at most t of them are correct. Are labels that come from Byzantine processes. So it will follow that a majority of those labels, which is at least t plus 1, will be from correct processes. And what I've just argued above is that the clean value is going to be exactly the same as the original value, so which will be is equal to v. And therefore, when you apply the cleaning procedure, and you change the value of X, is actually going to be exactly the same value that it had before. So it's going to be V. And so this is the proof of the difficult lemma that says that if X is a label that ends with the correct processes, then the label is very nice. There's a question?
Yeah, is there a reason why you are not reporting those nodes as you go down the tree, or is just an optimization?
Oh, no, there's a reason for this. The algorithm wouldn't work if you were not eliminating. So you're asking, why are we eliminating certain children from the tree? And the protocol wouldn't work. And I think we're going to see why once we look at how are we going to be using the nice labels in order to show that the decision in the end is going to be correct. But yeah, it's not an optimization. It's required. Now, a corollary of this, the hard lemma, is that we have the validity property of consensus. Now, recall the validity property of consensus, and I should mention this, that this protocol is, the validity property of consensus, if processes all start with a different value, the validity property of consensus is trivial to satisfy. Because when you have Byzantine failures, the validity property says has only a requirement if all the correct processes start with the same value. And so what we need to do to show the validity property is assume that all the correct processes have the same value, because otherwise the property holds vacuously. And so assuming that all the correct processes have V as initial value, and if you look at the children of the root at any correct processes, then you realize that there's going to be a majority of these correct, a majority of these nodes are going to be, of these children are going to be correct children, and they're going to have, they're all going to be labeled V. And so by the lemma that we have above, all these children of that refers to correct processes are going to be very nice. And so upon cleaning up the value, the cleaned up value of the root is also going to be V. But if you recall from the algorithm, the value that you decide is going to be the cleaned value of the roots. So that means that all the correct processes will decide V. In other words, what I've shown here is that if all the correct processes start with V, they execute the algorithm, they clean up the tree, the root ends up with V, they decide V. And that's the validity property of consensus for Byzantine failures. Now, the harder property to show, well, it's not so hard once you have the previous lemma proven, is to show the agreement property. And the agreement property, well, we essentially show the agreement holds in the previous, in the validity property, if all the correct processes start with the same value. But we need to show this property holds even if all the correct processes start with different values. And in order to show this, we have essentially to show that the root node is very nice. Because if the root node, sorry, we have to show that the root node is nice. Because if the root node is nice, that means that the value that appears at all the correct processes are going to be exactly the same. So in the simple case is when all the children of the root are nice. And so if all the children of the root are nice, then if you look at the definition of the cleaning procedure, it's going to be the fact that the root is also going to be nice. And the reason for this is because the cleaning procedure does exactly the same thing at all the correct processes. So the correct processes will look at the majority of the children, will see if there is a value that appears a majority of times. And if that value appears, it will change the root to be that value. In every process, the assumption that the children are all nice means that all the correct processes have exactly the same value at their children, at the children of the root node. And if they have exactly the same value at the children of the root node, when they apply this procedure that will clean up the root node, they obtain the same value. Now the question is, what happens if a child is not nice? Well, what we do is we examine each child one at a time. And we're actually going to show that all the children are nice. And so the root is also going to be nice. Well, we've shown that if you have a child that has a label that ends with the correct process, then the child is going to be super nice. Well, if it's super nice, that implies it's also nice. And so we're going to have lots of children of a given node. In this case, I'm just showing the root nodes. So we're going to have that lots of children are going to be super nice, and therefore they're going to be nice.
But have you defined super nice?
What's that?
Yes,
nice and super nice are here.
You mean very nice?
Oh, sorry, very nice. Very nice. This is a typo on the slides. It's very nice. Do I have here super nice? Yeah, no, it's very nice, not super nice. I'll fix the typos in the slides and I'll post this in the website when it's done. But it's very nice. Yeah, this is terminology that I changed in the last minute. But yeah, very nice. So what happens is that the labels that end with correct process are going to be very nice, and therefore they're going to be nice. What happens with the labels that don't end with correct process? Well, there's not many of these labels, but we're going to show that these labels are also, well, they're not necessarily super nice, but they're going to be at least nice, or very nice, but they're going to be at least nice. So what do? We take one such label that doesn't end with a correct process, and we look at their children. Now, we know that many of these children will be very nice. And so therefore, they're going to be nice. But some of the children may not be very nice because these labels end with a process which is not correct. So what do we do with those guys? we go ahead and look at their children. And their children, some of them are going to be very nice. If those are the children whose label end with the correct processes. But there are going to be some labels that don't end with the correct process. And those guys, well, they may not be very nice. And then you look at their children. And you just continue executing this until, and I claim, you're going to get to a level where all the children are going to be very, are going to be coming from label a label that ends with the correct process. And for those children, they're going to be very nice, and therefore they're going to be nice. And the reason why you're going to come to this level, so this is a level with all greens, is because if you look at the path from the root here, whenever we're following an edge like this that has a question mark, here we have a process which is not a correct process. And by the construction of the tree, when I create the children of a given node here, and this is the question that Lorenzo asked, I'm not repeating processes that have appeared previously in the path. So they're all distinct processes. And so this label ends with the identity of a process which is not correct. This label ends with the identity of a different process which is not correct. And once you go down further enough, you're going to exhaust your budget of Byzantine or processes that are not correct, which is at most T. So you're going to get to a level where all the children are going to be labels of processes. They're going to be labels that end with the correct process. And once you get to that level, all the labels are going to be very nice, and therefore they're going to be nice. And once all the labels are nice, when you execute the cleaning procedure, we can conclude that the parent is also nice. And in this way, we can also conclude in the same vein here that the parent of this guy is also going to be nice. When you execute the cleaning procedure, the parent is also going to be nice. And finally, we get to the root label and conclude that the label is also the label of the root is also nice. And that shows the agreement property. So we have shown all the properties of consensus. I didn't argue about termination because termination is due to the fact that you execute the algorithm for T plus one rounds and then you decide. I've shown the validity in the agreement property. So in conclusion, when you have synchronous systems, and we looked at the round-based synchronous systems, we can solve consensus with crash failures and it takes T plus one rounds. We can solve consensus with Byzantine failures provided that less than n over 3 processes are Byzantine. And you can actually show, and I haven't done this, shown this here, that this requirement is necessary. So if you have a third of the processes being Byzantine or more, you cannot solve consensus in synchronous systems. And in the algorithm that I gave you, I've shown that it takes T plus one rounds to do so. And you can also show that T plus one rounds is required for you to solve consensus with Byzantine failures. Now, in the next part of this lecture, I'm going to talk about asynchronous systems. There was a question there. No, so the definition of the round-based model is that processes all execute in lockstep mode, where in each round, a process sends a message to everybody, receives the message from everybody, and then proceeds to the next round. Now, if you do have bounds on message delays and bounds on the processing time of messages, then you can construct this round-based model. But throughout here, in the synchronous system, I was assuming the round-based model where processes just execute that way. Yeah, and plus you need the fact that the processing time of message is also bounded. So let me just mention from the get-go that the results that I mentioned for synchronous systems may or may not hold for asynchronous systems. And in fact, now that we're going to look at asynchronous systems, we're going to see that some things in those such systems become impossible, such as consensus. And we're also going to see some ways to circumvent that impossibility result. So in an asynchronous system, there are no bounds on the relative speed of processes, which means that some processes may be executing very slowly, other processes may be executing very quickly. And so you don't have this round-based structure that you can impose in synchronous systems, where in each round, everybody is sending to everybody, receive the messages, and proceed to the next round. If one process is much slower than the other, the process may fall behind in the execution, and the faster processes may execute many more steps than the process which is very slow. There are also no bounds on message delay. So even if all the processes are super fast, maybe it's the case that one process sends a message to another process. That message is not received immediately. It may take a very long time for the message to arrive, or some messages may arrive very quickly. And such systems, like synchronous systems, might be subject to process and link failures. several different flavors of process failures. We have fail-stop, crash failures, Byzantine failures. And our focus here is going to be on crash failures, but also going to consider fail-stop failures. And so crash failures is exactly the same as we had before. When a process crashes, it stops executing. And the assumption is that the crash is permanent. The process doesn't come back. If you have a fail-stop failure, that's very similar to a crash failure. But the difference is that other processes learn the fact that the process has crashed. Whereas if you have a crash failure, that may not occur. Now, the system is also subject to link failures. When you send a message, the message may be dropped, or messages may be duplicated, or messages may be spuriously created. But for simplicity, in this presentation, I'm going to assume the existence of reliable links. And as I mentioned before, for synchronous systems, we can make that assumption because there are protocols that are able to mask those failures where messages are dropped by doing retransmissions, or messages are created by checking CRCs and so forth. So we're going to assume no link failures, links are reliable. And so the model really is that you have a system with n processes, and they're going to be denoted P1, P2, Pn. And a process is just going to be modeled as an automaton that possibly has infinitely many states. If you will, you can model a process as a Turing machine, but we're actually giving the process is a much greater ability than just that of a Turing machine. So we're even allowing processes to solve the halting problem because they have an infinite automaton to store the state. And processes execute in steps. And in each step, a process may send a message to a single other process if it wants to send a message. It receives messages sent to it previously that it hasn't received before. Or maybe it receives the new message, either because there are no such pending messages, or because those pending messages are being delayed and they're going to be received only later. And then finally, the process changes its state. In other words, a step send message, receive message, possibly no change states. And a run on an execution of an algorithm is going to be an infinite sequence of steps. Here, I give an example of such an infinite sequence. And just as a matter of terminology here, so when I'm looking at the execution, I have a bunch of steps. In each step, I'm going to put a name of the process here, in this case, P1, P2, P1, P1, P3. So P1 is taking a step, P2 is taking a step, P1 is taking back a step, and so forth. And I'm going to put as a subscript the message that the process receives in that step, which could be the new message if there isn't any message for the process to receive or if the message is being delayed. And because we have asynchronous systems, it's not the case that processes execute at the same rate. And so you could have P1 appearing multiple times here before another process takes a step. Or you can have a process that only takes steps one time every 10,000 steps of P1 and so forth. And I'm going to say that a process has crashed if it only appears finally many times in this infinite sequence. And the intuition here is that the process, at the last time it takes a step, at that point it has crashed, has stopped taking steps. Now, the case of fail-stop failures in asynchronous systems turns out to be easy to address. Now, what is a fail-stop failure? It's one in which if a process crashes, other processes learn the fact that the process has crashed, the process has stopped taking steps, by receiving a special message that just gets injected into the system. And so the process learns the fact that a process that hasn't crashed learns the fact that the process that has crashed has done so. In the case of fail-stop failures, as we'll see later, is going to be a special case of a failure detector. Now, my claim is that if you have an asynchronous system with fail-stop failures, that system is going to be equivalent to a synchronous system with crash failures. In fact, it's going to be equivalent to the round-based synchronous systems that we saw in the previous part of this lecture. And by equivalent, I mean that if you're given an algorithm that executes in one system, you can execute exactly, and you can simulate exactly the execution of the algorithm in the other system, and that simulation is going to produce the same result that the algorithm would have produced in the original system. And to show the equivalence, we need to show that we can do that in both ways. So we can take an algorithm that was designed for the synchronous round-based system, and we can execute and run this algorithm in the asynchronous system with fail-stop failures. And similarly, we can take an algorithm that was designed for the asynchronous system, fail-stop failures, and we can run that algorithm and simulate the execution of that algorithm in a synchronous system with rounds. So we need to show the two directions of this equivalence. In the first direction, let's say, given an asynchronous systems with fail-stop failures, we went to be able to simulate the rounds of a synchronous system with crash failures. And so in other words, I'm given this algorithm that tells you what to do in round one, what to do in round two, what to do in round three, and I have the asynchronous system. I need to simulate those rounds. Well, to simulate those rounds, what a process does is exactly you look at the message that the process is supposed to send in that round, and you actually send a message to all the other processes. And you put a tag with a round number saying, OK, this is the message that the process is sending in round K. You attach the tag to the message that you send. And then for each process, you wait to receive those messages that are tagged with K. And when you receive that message that are tagged with K, you know what are the messages that the algorithm in round maze messages has sent. So you consider to be that set of messages that it received. Now, there's the case where a process crashes and doesn't send any messages. But if you have fail-stop failures, at least you get a notification that says, yes, that process has crashed, which means that you can move on and continue executing the next round once you receive that notification. And if you recall that in a round-based system, processes can also crash. And if a process crashes, you don't receive that message. So if you receive a notification that a process crashed, you just deal with it in the same way that the algorithm deals with missing messages in the round-based model. And in this way, you can simulate exactly the execution of the algorithm in the round-based model using the asynchronous system with fail-stop failures. In the other direction, is also possible to show, and it's, in fact, slightly easier. But if you're giving asynchronous systems with crash failures, you can simulate an asynchronous system with fail-stop failures. And the basic idea is that in order to send a message, and you're giving the round-based system, you can just broadcast that message to all the other processes in the round-based system. And I leave that as a homework for you to convince yourself that this indeed will produce a correct simulation of the other algorithm. I think what's more interesting when you have asynchronous systems is when you have crash failures, when a process stops executing quietly, and other processes may not be aware that the process has crashed, and the other processes are not able to distinguish the fact that the crash process has stopped executing from another scenario where the process hasn't really crashed, but it's just executing extremely slowly, and it's failing to send messages just because it's extremely slow. Because you notice that in an asynchronous system, you're there, you have crash failures. The only way that you know that another process is not executing is you're not receiving the messages from the other processes. But that could be just because the other process is executing very slowly. And we're going to show that in a system where you have such crash failures, it's impossible to solve some basic fundamental problems, such as the consensus problem that we looked at, and other problems that are equivalent to consensus, such as atomic broadcast and so forth. We're also going to see that there are ways to circumvent this impossibility result by using randomized algorithms or by using algorithms that rely on oracles that provide information about failures, which are called the failure detectors. But before I talk about all these things that are impossible, let me talk about a problem that you can solve in an asynchronous system with crash failures, which is reliable broadcast. Reliable broadcast resembles, in some ways, terminating reliable broadcast, but it's slightly different. It's defined in terms of two primitives, broadcast and deliver. And I'm going to assume, when defining reliable broadcast, that every message that is going to be broadcast includes two fields, the sender of the message, which refers to the process that wants to send a message, and a sequence number that the sender attached to the message when it sends that message. And the sequence number makes all these messages unique. So reliable broadcast requires the following three properties to hold, the first one being that if a correct process broadcasts a message, then all the correct processes eventually deliver that message. Agreement says that if a correct process delivers a message, then all the correct processes deliver the message. And this property is relevant in the case when the sender of the message is not a correct process. And so the agreement property says it's not the case that because the sender is incorrect, has failed to send a message to some of the processes, some correct processes deliver the messages and other correct processes do not deliver the message. Agreement says all the correct processes have to deliver exactly the same set of messages. And the integrity property says that you're not delivering messages out of the blue. If you're delivering a message, it is because the message was previously broadcast. And because we're making the assumption that messages are unique, so no message gets broadcast twice, you're also not allowed to deliver a message twice as well if you're a correct process. There's also a uniform variant of this problem, which is also defined in terms of the two primitives and the three properties, and the properties are slightly stronger in the case of uniform. In the case of agreement, the property is strengthened to uniform agreement, that says that if any process, whether the process is correct or not, delivers a message, then all the correct processes have to deliver that message. So in other words, it's not possible for one process to deliver a message, crash, and then the correct processes do not deliver that message. That means that when designing the algorithm, we have to be careful. Before a process delivers a message, the process may always crash, right? Before the process delivers a message, it has to ensure that other correct processes will receive that message so that they will also deliver such message. And the uniform integrity is like the integrity property, but it says that for all processes, not just the correct ones, you're not delivering messages out of the blue. So this is how you solve reliable broadcast with crash failures. And the algorithm is fairly simple. The basic idea is that if you want to broadcast a message M, you just send a message to everybody. And when you receive such a message that was sent, for the first time that you receive such a message, you go ahead and you send that message again to everybody. So you're basically flooding the message. So, and in addition to do that, you go ahead and you deliver the message. So I'm going to show that the simple protocol satisfies the three properties that I gave you for reliable broadcast. And in fact, it satisfies the three properties for uniform reliable broadcast as well. The first property is validity, that says that you're not, if you're a correct process and you broadcast a message, then eventually you deliver the message. Well, if you're a correct process and you broadcast a message, you're sending to everybody. In particular, you're sending to yourself. And when you send to yourself, eventually you receive that message. When you receive that message, you go ahead and you deliver that message. The agreement property says that if a correct process delivers a message, then all the correct processes also deliver the message. Well, you notice that in order to deliver a message, before doing so, a process sends the message to everybody else. And when it sends a message to everybody else, that ensures that the correct process will receive that message and will also deliver the message if they haven't done so already. And you notice that this property also holds even if the process that delivers a message crashes later on. So it shows the uniform agreement property as well. And the integrity property that says you don't deliver spurious messages out of the blue, you can see that the property holds because in order to deliver a message, you must have received the message. But if you receive the message, you can trace back the origin of the message from eventually somebody who has actually sent the message initially. And that process that initially sent the message, the process that broadcast the message. And in fact, you can show that the uniform version of this property holds exactly for the same reason. And so that shows that the three properties of reliable broadcast and, in fact, of uniform reliable broadcast are satisfied by this algorithm. Okay, now let's briefly cover the definition of consensus. And the consensus was defined by the three properties, the agreement, the validity, and the termination property. The agreement property says that correct processes have to decide on the same value if they decide anything at all. The validity property says that you correct process has to decide a value that is one of the initial values. And the termination property says that eventually correct processes decide. And I'm going to show you that this problem cannot be solved in systems, in asynchronous systems subject to crash failures. And that is true even if at most one process may crash. There's an upper bound on the number of processes that may crash, and that upper bound is exactly one. And so this process, this result is quite surprising. It has some deep implications in distributed computing and distributed systems in general. Let me show some of the implications of this result. And the first implication is that if you have an asynchronous system with crash failures, you cannot hope to be able to simulate the execution of synchronous systems with crash failures. And the reason why this is true is because if you could simulate the execution, you could take the algorithm that I gave for you for consensus for such synchronous systems, execute that in an asynchronous system, and solve consensus, which violates the impossibility result of consensus for asynchronous systems. In the same vein, you also, in an asynchronous system with crash failures, you cannot simulate an asynchronous system with fail-stop failures. Because again, if you could do that, if you recall that an asynchronous system fail-stop failures can simulate a synchronous system with crash failures, and once you do that simulation, go ahead and run an algorithm for consensus. Another implication of the impossibility results is that you cannot implement primitives that themselves can be used to solve consensus, and some of these primitives include atomic broadcast, for example. So this impossibility result is known as the FLP result, which is named after Fischer-Lynch and Patterson. And let's take a break before I go and give the proof of this algorithm, but let me just, as a warm-up, say that the proof is going to be based on the notion of valency and bivalency that we saw last time. So let's take a break for 5 minutes, and we'll continue with the FLP result proof after that. Okay, so let's continue with the proof of the consensus impossibility result in asynchronous system with crash failures. That's the FLP result. As I mentioned before, it's also based on the notion of bivalency, which is really at the heart of the proof of the FLP results. And if you recall, we used the notion of bivalency to show the lower bound of t plus 1 rounds for solving consensus in synchronous systems. And we had an argument that proceeded by contradiction. Well, we're also going to use a similar argument that proceeds by contradiction to show the FLP result. So assume by contradiction that there is an algorithm A that can solve consensus in an asynchronous system despite the fact that processes may fail by crashing, and up to one process may fail by crashing. So there's two possibilities: no process crashes or one process crashes. We're going to make the assumption that the algorithm is solving binary consensus where the initial values are either 0 and 1. And we can make that assumption because if your algorithm claims to solve the general version of consensus, it can also solve the restricted binary version of consensus where the input values are either 0 or 1. And we're going to show that we're going to reach a contradiction by showing that this algorithm A that you claim to solve consensus actually is going to violate the termination property of consensus. So a configuration of the system is going to consist of the states of all the processes at a given time, where the state of the process contains, for example, if your algorithm has variables, the value of all the variables that the algorithm has. And we're going to say that a configuration is v-valent if you try to execute from that configuration, the only possible decision value is going to be v. And we're going to say that the configuration is univalent if it's either 0 valent or 1 valent. So v valent for v equals 0 or v equals 0 or v equals 1. And the configuration is bivalent if it's not univalent. What that means is that from that configuration, there's a continuation of the execution where processes decide 0, and there's a continuation of execution where processes decide 1. And as before, the notion of valency being univalent essentially means that the decision has already been determined, though processes may not know about it. And the notion of being bivalent means that the decision has not yet been determined. It could go one way or the other. Okay, so this is an outline of the proof. I'm going to be showing two key properties, which are called lemma 1 and lemma 2. So lemma 1 is going to show that for your algorithm, which you claim to solve consensus, there's going to be some initial configuration before any process has executed any steps that's going to be bivalent. And this is being illustrated in this figure here. So in this figure, what I've shown here, I'm trying to get this to get started again. Okay. In this figure here, what I've shown in this gray area here represents a set of all the bivalent configurations or states of the algorithm A. And what the first lemma or first property is showing is that there exists an initial configuration that sits in the gray area. Now, the configurations that are outside the gray area are those in which the decision has already been reached. So lemma 1 says that you may start inside the gray area. And what lemma 2 says is that if you take any step that you can apply at a given configuration by a certain process P, for example, process P takes a step and receives a message M. If you take that step, that would take you out of the gray region. So if P were to execute that step, that takes you out of the gray region. So it takes a step that determines that decision has occurred and now becomes univalent. It becomes either 0 valent or 1 valent. If that's the case, there exists another execution in which if you delay that step by long enough, and delay that step means other processes executes other steps, receives other messages, and so forth. So if you delay that step for long enough, then you're going to remain in the gray region, which means you're going to remain in a configuration which is bivalent, a configuration in which the consensus decision has not yet been reached. And once I've shown these two properties, the first one is that you can start in the gray region. And for any step that gets you out of the gray region, if you delay that step, it's possible that you postpone the step and the step no longer takes you out of the gray region. Then I've shown to you that you're not able to solve consensus, because I will be able to construct an execution that starts in the gray region and continues in the gray region forever. Let me just mention a little bit of terminology here, which is PM represents a step where P takes a step and receives message M, which could be the new message. And this sigma here represents a sequence of steps, which does not include the PM step by process P. So let me show the first lemma, which there exists in a configuration which is initially bivalent. And the proof is actually very similar to the proof that we had for the lower bound of T plus 1 rounds for consensus in the synchronous round-based system. So I'm not going to go into the details of the proof all over again, but the basic idea is you proceed by contradiction. You assume that all the initial configurations are univalent. And if they are univalent, that means they're either zero-valent or one-valent. You know that all the configuration where processes all start with zeros is zero-valent. The configuration where other process starts with one is one-valent. You consider all these neighboring configurations that transition slowly from the 0-0-0 to the 1-1-1 configuration, and you're going to find a place where the configuration has to transition from 0-valent to 1-valent, and that differs only by the state of one process. And what you do is you consider an execution where that process, which is the only process that knows the difference between being 0-valent and 1-valent, crashes, never executes, and you reach a contradiction in that case, because in one execution, the process have to decide 0. In another execution, process have to decide 1. But the only process that knows the difference doesn't have a voice there. So the interesting lemma in the FLP proof is the second lemma. But before I show you what the second lemma is, let me show you in more detail how to get an execution that violates termination of algorithm A using the second in the first lemma. And there was a question here. So the question is that in the proof of the previous lemma, some processes may take a very long time to respond. And the question is whether the argument holds. Yes, yes. And so the assumption is they have an algorithm that can solve consensus, and that algorithm has to tolerate the failure of any single process, right? And so what we do here is that we start with this configuration. We consider an execution where this process, P3, that is the only process that knows the difference between these two configurations, crashes at the beginning. Now, the assumption we are proceeding by contradicting is that your algorithm A solves consensus. Therefore, if A were to execute from this initial configuration, despite the fact that some processes may take a very long time to respond and so forth, the algorithm eventually needs to be able to solve consensus, and eventually it will reach a decision. And in this case, the decision has to be 0. In the other case, the decision has to be 1. But these executions are exactly the same, because as I mentioned, the only process that knows the difference never executes. Well, if a process is slow, for example, it may take a long time to take a step, or if the links can have unbounded delays, when a process takes a step, it may receive the new message for a very long time. For many, many steps, it may receive the new message, even though there was a message that was sent to it. But the assumption that we're making is that the links are reliable, and if a message has been sent to a process P, it will eventually be the case that P takes a step and receives that message. So in other words, if you have an execution where a message gets sent to P, and P only receives the new message forever, that is an execution where a message has been sent to P, but P never received the message. We don't need to, for the algorithm to have termination in such executions. The algorithm is only required to terminate in the executions where these messages that get sent to P are eventually received by P, assuming that P is a correct process. So what I'm saying is that the model allows such executions where P never takes a step, or nobody ever takes, only one process. But then those executions would be executions where there's more than T failures or more than one failure, or executions where a message gets sent to a process and the message gets never received. And then the algorithm is not required to terminate in such cases. Okay. Before I show you the second lemma, which is the hard one to show, I'm going to show you how to use both of these lemmas to create an execution of the algorithm A that never terminates. And the basic idea is what I illustrated previously in this figure, that you start in the grade region, you take steps, and you remain in the grade region forever. But when we construct this execution, we have to make sure that all the correct processes are taking steps. We cannot just take any execution where only like P1 takes steps. And when we construct the execution, we have also to make sure that all the messages that are sent to a correct processes are eventually received by a correct processes. In other words, we cannot have this execution where processes never terminate to be the execution where all the processes all the time receive the new message. We have to make sure that if a process tries to send a message, the recipient is correct, the recipient correct receives the message. And in fact, the execution that I'm going to show you of algorithm A, all the processes are going to be correct. All the processes are going to be taking infinitely many steps. And despite the fact of that, all the messages are going to be received. Despite the fact of those, you will still be the case that the processes will never be able to decide. And the reason why they never be able to decide is because the configuration will remain bivalent forever. And so this is the algorithm that takes algorithm A and creates this infinite execution. So we start off with a bivalent initial configuration from lemma 1. And that gives you an assignment of initial value for each one of the processes. So it may be the 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1 initial value for processes P1, P2, and so forth. And then you execute forever. Now, in this execution, I'm going to tell you how the execution of algorithm A proceeds. So this is an algorithm that tells you how to execute algorithm A. So in each loop of this execution, we're going to pick one process to take a step. And we're going to do this in a round-robin fashion. We first pick P1 to take a step, we pick P2 to take a step, and then we force P2 to take a step, we pick P3 to take a step, and so forth. And for each process that we pick, let's say we pick process P, we pick the message that has been sent to that process, that is the oldest message that has been sent but has not yet been received. Now, the reason why we're picking this message is because we want to make sure that the execution that we create, that message really gets received. And we're going to create a process, we're going to create a step by process P that actually receives such message. And so we let PM be the step of P that receives the message M. Now, S is the execution that we're trying to create. So S is an infinite sequence of steps. And we started off with the initial configuration. Now we look to see, is it the case that if you add the step of process P, where P receives message M, is it the case that the configuration remains bivalent? And if it is the case that the configuration remains bivalent, then I just add that step to my execution, and I move on to the next process. So if I picked P1 here, the next process that I pick is P2, and then I ask myself, is it the case that if I add P2 to that execution, receiving the oldest message that was sent to it, the configuration remains bivalent? If so, yes, I add that to my execution. Now, what happens if I pick a process that is going to receive the message M and the configuration is no longer bivalent? Well, from lemma 2 that I'm going to show you later, we can find a sequence of steps that doesn't include that step, the step of PM, such that if you include a subsequence of steps between the current execution that I have and the step of P, then the configuration that we get is still going to be bivalent. And if I keep executing this loop forever, what I get in the end is a sequence of steps of algorithm A where the configuration remains bivalent forever. And if the configuration remains bivalent forever, that means that no process has ever decided, because if a process decides, that means the decision value has already been determined. Yes? Yeah, but the reason why you're taking the oldest message in this step here, M, is that if you didn't take the old message, you may end up in an execution where a message gets sent, but that message is never received. Now, if you have an execution where a message is sent and a message is never received, there's no requirements that your algorithm terminates. And so this wouldn't be an execution that violates the algorithm, the correctness of the algorithm. And so that's why you have to pick the oldest message. And the other thing to notice in this proof is that in this loop, we're executing for every process. So we're making sure that every process in this infinite execution takes infinitely many steps. Because if I were to omit a process, let's say P1 doesn't take a step, or infinitely many steps, or even there are two processes that don't take infinitely many steps, this would be an execution where two processes have crashed, because a crash process is one that takes finitely many steps. And we get an execution that, OK, processes don't terminate, they don't reach consensus, but they also violate the threshold, the upper bound in the number of failures that you had, which is, in this case, only one.
Absolutely, yeah. So,
yes.
Not really necessary.
Yes. Well, what it can do, for example, is you could pick the second oldest message in one iteration of the loop, and in the next iteration, then you go and pick the oldest message, right? But you can think of this as being, in some sense, like the simplest algorithm that would ensure that all these messages that are sent get received. OK, I'm going to go ahead and show the second lemma now, which says that if I have a configuration which is bivalent, and I have a step of a process that I want to add to that configuration, there's a way to add a step, provided that we find and keep the configuration bivalent, provided that maybe you insert some step of other processes in the middle. And the way the proof proceeds is by contradiction. So by contradiction, what does that mean? That means that for every sequence of steps sigma that doesn't include the step PM, if I take S, I include the steps of sigma, and I include the step that I'm looking at, the PM, we're going to get to a configuration which is univalent, which means it's either zero valent or one valent. OK, so I'm going to use this figure to help us go along with the proof. So in this figure, what I'm representing here is, in red, a bivalent configuration, which is the configuration that we start with. And here, I'm representing the step of process P receiving message M. And the assumption that we're making, as I said, is that no matter what we pick as a sequence of steps here, if PM takes a step, the configuration becomes univalent, which means either zero valent or one valent. We can assume without loss of generality that if PM takes a step from S, it's going to be zero valent. Because it's either zero valent or one valent. If it's one valent, you can just switch all the zeros and ones in this proof. So I'm going to assume it's zero valent. Now, we know that S is a bivalent configuration, which means that there is a way to continue the execution such that processes decide zero or processes decide one. That also means that there's a way to continue execution such that we get to a one valent configuration. And we're going to represent one valent configurations using the green dots here. And so there's a sequence of steps that, starting from S, if we were to execute those steps, we would get to the one valent configuration. My claim is that that sequence of steps that leads you to the one valent configuration, we can assume, without loss of generality, that the step PM by process P receiving message M occurs exactly at the end. And the reason we're making this assumption is because of the following. Well, maybe the sequence doesn't include at all the step PM of process P receiving message M. If it doesn't include a step, we can just add it to the end. Because if the configuration was one valent and we add the PM step, it also remains one valent. The other possibility is that the sequence that takes you to a one valent configuration includes PM step in the middle of it as opposed to the end of it. Well, if it includes in the middle of it, we can just truncate that sequence as soon as that step has occurred. And because we're assuming that no matter what we do, if we include a step of PM, the configuration becomes univalent, if we truncate at that point where the configuration, where PM takes a step, it becomes univalent. And that point, for example, that point could have been here. Let's say the PM step is here instead of being at the end. So here it will become univalent. And the question is, could it be zero valent? I mean, if it's univalent, it's either zero valent or one valent. Could it be zero valent? And it cannot be zero valent because there's a continuation of it which is one valent. Zero valent means no matter what you do, the execution is going, process is going to decide zero. So you can't go from a zero valent to a one valent configuration. Well, if it is the case that PM took a step here and the result configuration was already zero valent, then I could have just truncated my execution and assumed that, in fact, PM is the process which is taking the last step before we get to the one valent configuration. OK, so we have a picture that looks like this, but there was a question. Yeah, well, the decision of whether it's one valent or not, you have to have some omniscient God that looks at the execution and see, from this current configuration, is it the case that if all the processes were to execute, they would always decide the same value? That would be a univalent, right? So, and depending on what steps you take, you may, no, if you have to solve consensus, eventually you have to decide a value. Now, if you have decided a value, you're definitely at a univalent configuration. You may reach a univalent configuration even before you have decided, right? So, I'm not sure if that answers exactly your question, but.
I mean,
Well, a configuration is the state of all the processes at the same time bundled together, right? Yeah. You can look at any state and go to the same. Say that again, sorry.
You say the moment you see a particular message
error, yes.
You can go into the univalent configuration by changing a PM.
Yes.
And giving the process of PM, right? So it could have been that message could have been arrived in any state in the entire process.
No, in the particular state that we're looking at. So if you look at a given configuration, it includes the state of all the processes. And for example, over here. And so if PM were to take a step here, from that, and this configuration includes the state of PS1, includes the state of other processes, then the configuration would become univalent.
Can you go to the previous slide?
Well, the previous slide is just, it's just that. Yeah, that's right. So if PM were to take a step here instead of being at the end, well, so if PM were to take a step here, which is PM, P cannot take a PM step here anymore because it has already received the message, right? Unless the message has been sent twice. But so all this thing is saying is that we can assume that the step that PM takes, that takes it from the bivalent to the univalent configuration, is going to occur exactly at the end. The PM step is going to be at the end here. So I'm not saying that this state is necessarily going to be bivalent. In fact, this could already be univalent. I'm just saying that you can assume that the step is at the end, because if it's not in the sequence, you can put it at the end, you can put it in the sequence, and if it appears in the middle of the sequence, you can just truncate it there, and the assumption that we're making is that if PM takes a step, no matter what happens before, the configuration becomes univalent, and it has to be one-valent in this case, because if it were zero-valent, you can't continue for it to be one-valent. Well, the process can't make the distinction, but again, like here we are God, we're looking at the execution, and we can determine that once PM takes a step, maybe PM doesn't decide, but we can see and we can imagine all the possible continuations of execution. We see that from that point on, it's going to be univalent, or it's going to be like zero valent or one valent, one or zero becomes the only possible decision. And that may not be reflected in the state of any process. That is reflected only in the state of the union of all the processes in the system. So that's not something that the process realizes just yet. So you have to look at this from the broader perspective. So in the next step of the proof, we now have this gadget here where we're at the bivalent state S. PM takes a step, it's zero valent. If PM takes a step later, it's one valent. Now we're going to consider what happens if PM takes a step in the midst of each one of the steps that are occurring in the sequence. So what happens if, let's say, if this was a step by some process P0, what happens if PM takes a step right after P0 takes a step? And if the second step in the sequence was by a process P1, what happens after P0 and P1 both take a step and then PM takes a step? And the assumption that we're making is that if PM were to take a step, the configuration would be bivalent. And if it's bivalent, it's either zero valent or one valent. And here, I'm showing you one possibility that after the first step, it's still zero valent, but after the second step, or the K step, it becomes one valent, and finally it becomes one valent. But from where we started from, we know that if PM takes a step immediately, it's going to be zero valent. If it takes a step a little bit later, it's going to be one valent. That means that things are transitioning from zero to one, and we can find one place in the sequence where things transition from zero to one. There may be multiple places where transitions may transition back and then transition again, but we only care about one such transition. There's at least one such transition. And that transition is going to look like this. There is some process Q, which may or may not be the same as process P, takes a step and receives message X, which could be the new message. And if PM takes a step before the QX step, then the configuration is zero valent. And if PM takes a step after the QX step, it's going to be one valent. Oh, so why is this guy green? Because this guy is bivalent, and if it's bivalent, That means that, you know, if all these guys were going to be blue, then these guys would already be zero valent, because that means that zero is already being determined to be the decision. Right? And so that means that one of these guys has to be green. And so this gadget that I just detected here is commonly known as the hook, because it kind of looks like a hook in the FLP proof. And once we found the hook, we're basically done, because here, QX is the only process that knows the difference. So Q is the only process that knows the difference between a zero valent and a one valent state. Well, if that's the case, we can take this configuration, which is zero valent, and consider a continuation from there of the execution where Q doesn't take any steps at all. And the assumption is that the algorithm has to tolerate at least the algorithm has to tolerate one crash failure. In other words, the algorithm has to satisfy the properties of consensus even if one process stops taking steps. And in this case, Q has stopped taking steps. That means that from this configuration, eventually processes have to decide zero. And we can take exactly the same configuration here, the same continuation that occurred here, and apply to this other configuration. And exactly the same steps that processes were taking on the left, we can apply the exactly same step to the configuration on the right. And because processes are executing exactly the same step, as far as the algorithm is concerned, they're receiving exactly the same messages. When they receive the message, they send exactly the same messages. They have exactly the same behavior. Well, if they have exactly the same behavior, that means that processes will decide exactly the same value. But if they decide exactly the same value, that contradicts the fact that this is a one-valent configuration, because the same value is the value 0. But this configuration was non-valent, which means that any continuation from that configuration, processes would have to decide 1, but the process decides 0 instead. So this shows that lemma 2, this gets us into a contradiction and shows that lemma 2 holds. And so this is the recap of the proof. We'll show that we can start with a bivalent configuration, and we can show that if we try to get out of a bivalent configuration, we can insert steps, other steps, such that the steps that gets out of the bivalent configuration remain bivalent. And if we remain bivalent, then that means that processes never decide. OK, so in some sense, the FLP result is bad news, because consensus is a fundamental problem. You need to, for example, if you want to implement any form of replication where you have a bunch of different replicas, they're trying to keep the same state, and there are values being submitted to those replicas for execution. The replicas need to reach consensus on what the next input is before they go ahead and process that input. And so the consensus is also used to implement other primitives, such as atomic broadcast, or consensus is needed for group configuration. I think Robert Van Ranes may have talked about group membership and group reconfiguration before, but you need consensus to solve all these problems. And so it's kind of bad news, the fact that we can't solve consensus in a synchronous system subject to crash failures. But the good news is that there are certain ways for you to circumvent this impossibility result. And here I'm going to talk about two such ways, one of them being through the use of randomization, where processes are allowed to toss coins. And if that's the case, then you can solve consensus in a synchronous system subject to crash failures. And the other way to circumvent the result is to assume that processes have an oracle that gives you some possibly incorrect information about failures. But now, information cannot be all garbage, but if there is at least a seed of truth in the information that I get from the failure detector, and that seed of truth is going to be quite minimal, in fact, then you can already solve consensus that way. So let me start with the first approach to circumvent the impossibility result, which is through the use of randomized algorithms. And we're going to have to slightly weaken the definition of the consensus problem so that termination doesn't necessarily always hold, but it only holds with probability 1. In other words, the requirement here is that with probability 1, all correct processes eventually decide, as opposed to all correct processes always decide. And you may think that if something occurs with probability 1, it always occurs, but that's not the case at all. And in fact, this is different from always terminating. And here, to illustrate the difference, I give an algorithm that always terminates with probability 1, but it doesn't always terminate. And here's how this algorithm works. And this is not a distributed algorithm. This is a centralized algorithm. And it works as follows. So suppose that I tell you that you're supposed to toss a coin. And if the coin returns, either 0 or 1. And if the coin returns 0, then you're done. You terminate, you can go home. But if the coin returns a 1, then you have to toss the coin again. And when you toss the coin again, then you look at the value of the coin. If it's 0, Then you can terminate and you can go home. And if it's one, you're required to toss the coin again, and so forth. And I ask you, what is the probability that you're going to be so unfortunate to be tossing the coin and obtaining one all the time? And that could actually occur. It would be extremely unlucky if you always toss the coin, you always obtain one, assuming that the coin is not a bogus coin. Or suppose the coin has probability half. That would be extremely unlucky for you, but it's possible that it occurs, that you always toss the coin, you get the value one. And what is the probability that that happens? And I claim that probability is going to be zero. And the reason that probability is zero is that the probability that you toss the coin k times and you always obtain one for k times, assuming an unbiased coin, is going to be 2 to the minus k. And the probability that you toss the coin and obtain once forever is going to be less than 2 to the minus k for every k. Because that probability has to be an infinite sequence of ones for you to never terminate. And that probability less than 2 to the minus k for every k. But there's only one value which is less, and one positive value which is less than 2 to the minus k for every k, and that value is 0. So what I'm saying is that the probability that you always toss one forever is going to be zero. But it could happen if you're not very lucky. No, that's not the case. Here's another example. That's one of the unfortunate things about probability theory is that events with probability zero happens all the time, and events with probability one sometimes don't happen. So, for example, suppose you have a uniform distribution in the 0-1 interval. What is the probability that you pick a number which is, let's say, 1 over pi, or 0.5 or 0.3? The probability of you picking any such numbers in the 0-1 interval is going to be 0, yet you can go ahead and pick a number. Now, if you ask yourself, what is the probability that you're not going to pick 0.5? That's probability is 1. But you can go ahead and still randomly choose that value. So this is one of the things that bothers me about the theory of probability, that things with probability 0 happen, things with probability 1 are not ensured to happen all the time. And this is the case here. We have an algorithm that with probability 1 it terminates, but there are runs. If you're extremely unlucky, it could happen. And those runs could happen with probability 0, but it could still happen in practice. And this is another simple example of an algorithm that always terminates with probability 1. But if you're really unlucky, and there's a probability 0 that happens, you may never terminate. You're just always tossing ones. Right? And that's going to be the case for the Norris algorithm. So if you're really unlucky, you never terminate. But if you toss the good coins, then eventually you'll be able to terminate. And so the Norris algorithm is an algorithm that solves binary consensus. That means that the initial value is either 0 or 1. And there are ways to transform an algorithm that solves binary consensus into an algorithm that solves consensus for general values. And if you have enough time, we're going to look at one such algorithm. Now, Benoit's algorithm requires that a majority of processes is correct. In other words, T, which is the upper bound of the number of crash failures, is going to be less than N over 2. Or equivalently, N is greater than or equal to 2T plus 1. There's also a variant of Benoit's algorithm that tolerates Byzantine failures, which I'm not going to address here. But then it assumes that at most less than one-fifth of the processes are correct. Sorry, less than one-fifth of the processes are Byzantine. So we're just going to look at the crash version of the Benoit algorithm. And so in the Benoit algorithm, processes proceed in rounds. Now, these rounds have nothing to do with the rounds of the round-based synchronous system. These rounds are just an algorithmic-specific notion. A round is just going to be one iteration of a loop that processes are supposed to execute. And I should make the notion that because we are an asynchronous system, processes can be, at a given time, in different rounds. Because a round is one execution of the loop, maybe process 1 has executed 10 iterations of the loop, therefore it's in round 10, or round 11, if you will, while another process only executed 2 iterations of the loop, and so it's only in round 2 or round 3. So this is the code of the algorithm. Let's look at it slowly, step by step. So each process will keep a variable x, which starts off as the initial value that the process has in the definition of consensus. And the value is going to change over time. And you can think of that value as being an estimate of what the consensus decision should be. So the process initially thinks, well, it doesn't have any information that the consensus decision should be its own initial value because that's the best information that it has. But as it exchanges information with other processes, it's going to revise that notion, and it's going to change the value of x. And at some point, the process is going to see that, OK, this is a value that I can really decide. It's going to decide on that value. So processes execute in loops, and the loops are numbered 1, 2, 3, and so forth up to infinity. And each execution of the loop is going to be called a round. So here's what happens in a round. So at the beginning of each round, the process sends its estimates to all the other processes. And that message has two different tags. One tag is the round number. So this is saying, this is the message, this is the value of my estimate in round one, if k equals one. This value r here, this is not a variable. This is just a label that says this is the first type of message that I'm going to send, because later on, the process is going to send other types of messages in the algorithm. And the first message that the first type of message that the process sends, we're going to call this a report message. That's why we have the letter r here. So we're basically saying that the process is reporting its estimate to all the other processes, tagged with the round number and tagged with the letter r. And then the process is going to wait for the reports from all the other processes, from n minus t processes. And it's going to wait for messages that have the tag r, which corresponds to the report messages, and the tag k, which corresponds to this round number. And the star means it just can consider any message. It doesn't know really the value that it's going to receive. And it's going to wait for n minus t such messages. Let me make the observation that n minus t is the maximum number of messages that the process can hope to receive in a system where up to t processes can fail. If the process were to insist that I want to receive n minus t plus 1 message, the process could block forever. And the reason for this is because if it waits for n minus t plus 1 message, it's possible that t processes have crashed. They won't send that message. The process will never receive it. So here, it's really waiting for the maximum number of messages that it can ever hope to get. OK, now it received those n minus t messages that are reports from the processes. What it's going to do is you look at the messages and see if there is a majority of messages that have the same value v. In other words, is it the case that a majority of processes have reported the same value? Now, that may or may not be the case. If it is the case, then the process is going to send a proposed message, which is a message that has a special tag p. It is also tagged with a round number for the value that occurs a majority of times. So it's going to, we say that the process is going to propose v to all. Now, if it's not the case that the process receives more than a majority of reports with the same value, it's just going to propose a special value, which is denoted as a question mark, which basically means, you know, I don't know what to propose because I didn't have a majority of either 0 or I didn't have a majority of 1. And then the process is going to wait for such messages, the proposal messages, for that round from n minus t processes as well. And again, that's the maximum number of messages that it can hope to get. Now, once the process has received the proposal messages, it's going to check whether it can see that there are t plus 1 messages that are for the same value v that is not a question mark. And if it is the case that there are t plus 1 such messages, then the process decides on the value that came with that message, Now, if your process receives at least one, maybe not t plus 1, but at least one such message with a value different than question mark, then the process changes its estimate of the consensus decision to the value that it has received. Now, if the process receives all such messages with question mark, all such proposals with question mark, then the process will toss a coin and will change its estimate to 0 or 1 randomly, let's say with probability half each. So this is the entire algorithm. This is Benoit's algorithm. And my claim is that this algorithm solves consensus with termination with probability 1. Is there a question there? No. Now, there is a key notion to the correctness of the Benoit algorithm, which is the notion of being k-locked, where k is a round number. Like, a value is 1 locked, or a value is 2 locked, 3 locked for rounds 1, 2, or 3. So we say that a value is k-locked if it is the case that in the execution that we're considering, if we look at all the processes that start round k, they start round k with their estimate equal to v. So v could be either 0 or 1. So in other words, here's the case where value 0 is 1 locked. 1 locked means all the processes that start round 1 are going to start with value 0, 0 locked. 0 mean 0 is 1 locked, meaning all processes that start round 1 start with the estimate equals to 0. Well, that could happen if the initial value of all the processes are equal to 0. The value is going to be 2 locked if all the processes that start their second iteration of the loop, which is round 2, all start with the same value, which is v. And we're going to show some interesting properties about values being k-locked for various values of k and v. But before that, let me make a simple observation that it's for any given round, if you look at the round k, if you look at the proposals that were sent in round k by different processes, it's impossible that one process has proposed zero and another process proposed one in that round. And the reason for this is that if you recall the code of the algorithm, and here I'm just showing a chunk of the algorithm, not showing the entire algorithm, but in the code of the algorithm, the only way for a process to propose a value is that it has received more than n over 2 reports for that value. But each process sends only one report. So if you have a situation where one process proposes 0, another process proposes 1, that means that one process has received more than n over 2, a majority of reports for 0, another process has received more than n over 2, a majority of reports for 1. But here, processes are not Byzantine, they're just sending correct values. So it's not possible for processes to be reporting both 0 and 1, a process just reports 0 or 1. Now, the interesting property about values being k-log is the following. Your question?
Can we import the minimum value of k, which can be like, it will be equal to the total number of faults, which can occur?
Well, the minimum value of k is what? Well, that's not the case for Benard's algorithm, unfortunately not. So processes may have to execute an extremely large number of rounds before the value gets to be k-locked. But the goal is indeed for values to be k-locked and for the decision to be reached. So we're going to see that you may have to execute an exponential number of rounds, in fact, 2 to the n rounds for a value to be k-locked. And that's based on the coin tosses that you get. So the second lemma here is that if some process decides a value in round k, then at least that value is going to be k-locked in the next round. And so that value is going to be k plus 1 locked. And if you recall the code of the algorithm, the only way for a process to decide v is for it to receive t plus 1 proposals of the value for that value v. Now, if one process receives t plus 1 proposals, well, another process is also waiting for such proposals. And the question is, how many such proposals are the other process going to receive? Well, the other process is waiting for n minus t proposals. So other processes are waiting for n minus t proposals in round k, right? What is n minus t? That means that you receive all proposals, but you're missing t of them. But if this guy received t plus 1 proposals, you take another process which is receiving proposals as well. It's missing t of them. It's going to receive at least one proposal for the same value v. And if it receives that proposal for the value v, then it changes its estimate to the value v. And if it's changed the estimate to the value v, that means that when it starts the next round, it's going to be starting the next round with the estimate equal to v. And if we've shown this holds for every process, that means all the other processes are going to be starting the next round with the estimate equal to v. Now, the next property is that if a value is k-locked for round k, then every process that executes through round k will decide that value, which is k-locked. And if you recall the code of the algorithm, what you do in each round is you report the value of your estimate. You wait for the reports. If you receive a majority of those with the same v, you propose that value. You send a proposal for that value. You wait for the proposals. And then you check to see if you got all the same proposals, and then you decide. But what we're saying is that in round k, all the processes start the round with the same estimate. That means that everybody's going to report k. Everybody's going to report that value, which is value v. Well, if everybody reports v, then definitely going to receive more than n over 2 values with the same v, because you're waiting for n minus t, and t is a minority of processes. So n minus t includes at least n over 2 processes, perhaps more. And in fact, n minus t includes more than n over 2 processes, because t is less than n over 2. So that means that everybody's also going to propose that value. Nobody's going to propose question mark. And that also means that if everybody's proposing that value, you're going to receive at least t plus 1 proposal with the same value, v. And this is the reason for this is because t plus 1 is going to be less than n over t. You're going to receive exactly n minus t values that have exactly the same proposal, but t plus 1 is less than n over t. And this is due to the fact that t is going to be less than n over 2. And so all the processes are going to decide v. All the processes that execute that round is going to decide v. So a corollary of these lemmas is that if some process decides v in a given round, then every process that executes to the next round is also going to decide V. And the way you see this corollary is because if some process decides V in round K, we know that the value is going to be K plus 1 locked. And that's from lemma number 2. And if the value is K plus 1 locked, that means that every process that executes the next round K plus 1 is going to decide V. And therefore, the corollary holds. And from that, we have the agreement property of consensus, which basically says that processes will never decide different values, which is being stated slightly different here. If you have two processes, P and P prime, that decide V and V prime, then V is going to be equal to V prime. Well, if they decide V and V prime, they have to do so in a certain round. And I'm just calling these rounds K and K prime. In order to prove this property, you notice that if k equals k prime, in other words, if p and p prime decide v and v prime in the same rounds, then the value v must have been proposed, because recall that the code of the algorithm says that you decide value v if you receive t plus 1 proposals for that value. But we've shown in lemma 1 that you cannot have two different values being proposed in the same round. Therefore, they have to decide the same value. And in the case where k is different than k prime, and we can assume without loss of generality that k is less than k prime because the other k is completely analogous, then we can do repeated applications of corollary 1. So we have the case that p decides value v in round k. That means that p prime is going to decide value v in round k plus 1. And that follows from corollary 1. P prime is also going to decide value v in round k plus 2, and so forth up to round k prime. Now, when we have that P prime decides V in round K prime, well, by the first case, we have two processes that are deciding the same round. They have to decide the same value. It follows that both processes decide the same value. There's also the uniform validity property, which I'm going to skip for the sake of brevity, but you have this in the notes. But basically, this property holds because of the fact that when you have binary consensus, if processes have initial value 0 and 1, validity always holds, because processes decide either 0 or 1. That's going to be the initial value of the process. So the only interesting case, which is the case where validity might possibly be violated, is when all the processes start with the same value. But if the other processes start with the same value, that value is 1 locked. And if it's 1 locked, that value is going to be decided. So you're not going to decide a different value by the agreement lemma that we just showed. Now, termination property, we need to show that this algorithm terminates with probability 1. And we can think, in order to show termination, that there's a game going on between an adversary and the algorithm. An adversary is trying to delay the decision of the algorithm so that processes will never terminate. And the algorithm is doing its best in order to reach the decision. And so we can think of the algorithm as this player that controls the action of the correct processes. And so the algorithm can say, yeah, you're supposed to send this value now. If you receive this value, you're supposed to change your estimate and so forth, which is just Benor's algorithm. And the adversary is the player that controls the schedule of the processes. So it would say, no, P executes now. Now P2 executes now. Now P3 executes now. And every time that a process executes, it receives a certain message. And so we can think of this as being this game which is being played between the algorithm and the adversary. And we have to show that no matter what the adversary does, the algorithm wins and terminates with probability sufficiently high, in this case, with probability 1. Now, it turns out that there are different types of adversaries that may have different powers. So we can have a weak adversary. Again, the adversary is this process, is this entity that is controlling the scheduling of processes. And a weak adversary, when it's deciding on the schedule of processes, cannot see the internal state of the processes or the contents of messages. And without that information, the adversary is supposed to say, yes, now P2 executes, now P3 executes, and so forth. And we have a strong adversary that can see and has full information about the current state of all the processes and about the content of all the messages. Now, I should notice that the distinction between these two types of adversary is only relevant for randomized algorithms, because if the algorithm is not randomized, the adversary can just simulate in its own head what the algorithm would be doing, and the algorithm is not tossing any coins. If that algorithm is just deterministic, the adversary would be able to extract that information based on the simulation that it can do in its own head. But if you have a randomized algorithm, now the algorithm is tossing coins, the adversary doesn't know what is the value of the coin, and so the adversary in this case might be more limited than, and as again, this only holds for randomized algorithms. And in the proof that I'm going to present here, I'm going to make the simplifying assumption that the adversary is weak. But there are proofs of the Benora algorithm that also hold even for a strong adversary. And those proofs are significantly more complex than the proof I'm going to present here. So here's a termination argument. Recall that the first thing that we showed about Benora algorithm is that it's impossible for a process to propose 0 and a process to propose 1 in a given round k. You also notice from the algorithm that if a process gets a proposal for v in a given round, then it changes its estimate for that value. If a process only gets proposals for question mark, then it's going to go and toss a coin. And it's going to change its estimate to the value of the coin, which is either 0 or 1. Now, from the first lemma, you can only propose 0 or you can only propose 1. Now, let's say that you propose 0 in round k. Some process may get that proposal and change their estimate to 0. The processes that do not get a proposal, they cannot get proposal 1, may get only proposals of question mark. They're going to be tossing coins. Now, the coin has a probability half of being either 0 or 1. So there's a probability half that the coin that the process tosses matches exactly the proposal value that was sent in that round. So let's say it was 0. There's a probability half that when the process tosses a coin, it's going to toss exactly the value 0. And in fact, there's a probability at least 2 to the minus n that all the processes that execute that round, they're tossing the coins, they obtain exactly the value 0, which is the value that has been proposed in that round. So in other words, there are two types of processes that execute around. There are those that receive the proposal for 0, they change their estimate to 0, and there are those that toss the coins, they obtain 0 or 1. But there's a small probability that all these guys that toss coins obtain 0, and the probability is at least 2 to the minus n. This is what I just said. So now what we have is a situation that in round k, there's a probability that is at least 2 to the minus n that all correct processes end up the round with the same value. Well, if they end up the round with the same value, that means that the value is going to be k plus 1 locked. If the value is k plus 1 locked, that means they're going to decide that value in the next round. But what happens if they don't end up with the same value in the round? Well, they're going to execute another round in which there's a probability 2 to the minus n that all the processes that toss coins obtain exactly the value that was proposed in that round. And because we have this probability occurring over and over for possibly an extremely large number of rounds, the probability that actually you don't toss those, so the probability is very small that all the processes toss exactly the same coin. But because you just repeat this over and over, over, possibly an extremely large number of times, the likelihood that you're going to repeat this game, this situation, where you're tossing these coins and you never get the all zero or the all ones, is going to be zero. Because this is, again, a game in which processes are tossing coins. If you get a lucky value for those coins, which are all zeros in the round, they terminate. If you don't get it, you get to toss again. Now, the number of expected rounds for termination is going to be very large. It's going to be exponential in n. That's the expected. But eventually, you know, the probability that you'll never be able to get such luck coins is going to be zero. And that shows termination of the consensus algorithm. So I'm running out of time here. So what I'm going to do here is just to tell some interesting results. And you're going to have the proof of those results in the slides that are going to be available as notes to you. But what the consensus algorithm does is to solve binary consensus where the inputs are either 0 or 1. And this is important for the Benora algorithm because processes are tossing coins, which are either 0 when those coins are supposed to match the initial values of processes, which are either 0 or 1. But there are algorithms that allow, once you have binary consensus, to solve the general version of consensus where the initial values can be arbitrary values. So what we have so far is that the FLP shows that consensus is impossible, but we can circumvent this if we're willing to toss coins, and we can solve consensus with probability 1. Now, it turns out that there's another way to solve the consensus problem in a synchronous system, which is to assume that there's an oracle that gives you some partial information about failures in the system. And this oracle is called a failure detector. And the basic idea of a failure detector is that each process has a failure detector module that provides some hints about the set of processes that have crashed so far. And those hints can be incorrect. The failure detector can make mistakes. And there are some very interesting properties that define, that limit the extent that the mistakes that the failure detector can make. And different failure detectors have to satisfy different properties. And the failure detector can be compared based on the strength of such properties. And so I'm going to skip the definition, but I'm just going to say that there are some fairly weak failure detector that gives you a very small amount of information about failures. And you have to assume that it's coming from an oracle. You cannot implement such oracles, because if you could implement, you could solve consensus, deterministically speaking. Or maybe you could implement this oracle in a randomized fashion, though nobody knows how to do that. So you assume that such an oracle provides us more information about failures, then you can solve consensus. And what you have in the notes is basically the various different failure detectors that can be used to solve consensus. So what I'm going to skip to is a summary here. For asynchronous systems, we can solve consensus with failures. We show that even with crash failures, you can solve consensus. It implies that if you have worse types of failures, such as Byzantine failures, you can't solve consensus either. And this holds even if there's an upper bound of 1 on the number of processes that can be subject to such failures. However, we can solve the problem of reliable broadcast, which, now some people tell me, okay, but reliable broadcast processes are reaching consensus on the set of messages. Yes, it is a certain form of consensus, but it's not the consensus problem. So in reliable broadcast, if you recall the definition of problem, it ensures that other processes eventually deliver the same set of messages, but they don't have to deliver those messages in the same order. If they had to be delivered as messages in the same order, you have a different problem, which is called the atomic broadcast problem, and that would be equivalent to consensus. But the reliable broadcast is an easier problem that you can solve in asynchronous systems with crash failures. And I've also shown you that you can circumvent the impossibility result, assuming that the processes can toss coins, though you don't get termination all the time, only termination with probability 1. And the algorithm, Benoit's algorithm, assumes there's a majority of correct processes, and you can show that even for randomized algorithms, you require a majority of correct processes. And there's another approach to circumvent the possibility result, which is the failure detector approach, which I didn't explain here, but it's quite interesting, actually. It's in the notes, so if you're interested in the subject, I would highly recommend you to take a look at that material, because I think it's very interesting stuff. So to conclude this lecture with two parts, we gave here an overview of message passing algorithms, first for the synchronous round-based model, and we showed that with crash failures you can solve consensus with T plus one rounds. We also looked at some early deciding algorithms that are able to solve consensus fast in a smaller number of rounds if the actual number of failures is smaller than T. With Byzantine failures, I give you the full information protocol, where processes basically send everything they know in each round, construct this big tree, and are able to solve consensus in T plus one rounds, assuming that you have less than one third of the processes that are Byzantine, or in other words, n greater than or equal to 3T plus one. In asynchronous systems, I've shown you that if you have fail-stop failures, essentially you have a synchronous system, so you can simulate the round-based model. And if you have crash failures, no consensus, but you can get randomized consensus, or you can get consensus with failure detection. The other thing to take away from these lectures is that many of these algorithms that run in distributed systems are quite subtle, and it's quite easy, and sometimes they're kind of elusive as to why they work at all, and it's quite easy to make mistakes about whether they work or not, and if they work, why they work. And so it's pretty important to follow, in my opinion, a fairly rigorous treatment of such algorithms to make sure that when you're developing such an algorithm, you're not going to run into mistakes, because some of these algorithms sometimes escape our intuition. And the reason for that being that our intuition tends to be sequential. So we think in terms of A implies B implies C and implies D and so forth. But in this algorithm, we really have multiple things happening at the same time. And so you really need to have mathematics to help you reason about the correctness of such algorithms. And with that, I conclude my lecture. I'll be available during the break for any further questions you might have. Thank you.